Great. Hey everybody, how's it going? My name is Albert Huang. I'm going to be talking about 3D interaction design of the human body. Basically, 3D interaction has to occur with the human body if we exist in this dimensional space. The only way we can interact with content is with this sack of meat that we carry around that we know as the human body. I'm Albert Huang, and I'm a 3D information artist. I take information and I transport it around in three dimensions in ways that are emotionally intriguing. And you can find more information about me and my projects over at alberthuang.com and my Twitter handle is isochoose is at FedEx. And if you're here, you probably saw some of my artwork already. There's the Lumarca, or the Wire Map, it's also known as. That was in the exhibition hall. It was a three-dimensional biometric display. And I also do another thing called spatial computing, which is more pertinent to the theme of HCI. And spatial computing is a exploration of what it's like in the future to interact with three-dimensional content. Three-dimensional content comes out in a real 3D space. Our bodies can interact with those things. And what I'm going to start with is a discussion about the third dimension and how it relates to the second dimension, right? Because when we think about the third dimension in a computer point of view, right, from the perspective of machines, 3D is like awesome. It's like the newest, biggest thing, right? 3D is like, there are like stereo displays, lenticular displays, there's Kinect and all the sensors that we can input information into the machine. But from a human perspective, 3D is actually older than 2D, right? I mean, we've been on this planet. We've had to find food, we've had to find mates, create offspring, raise children. Evolutionarily, 3D is actually more pertinent to our survival than 2D. And the earliest cave drawings that we have of ourselves are of us, right? Of human beings doing three-dimensional tasks, like hunting. It seems like this person is carrying a spear around and hanging onto a bag, so obviously this person has astute three-dimensional capabilities. And the only way we can interact with 3D content is through our bodies. Right? And as I said, because 3D is crucial, and understanding 3D is crucial to our sense of survival, interacting with the human body is a way to really peak our emotional experiences. To really direct behavior, right? If you look at the interior design of a store, it's going to be designed for the human body to be able to pick up garments of clothing and put them right on your body and put them right back with ease. And the reason that is that this convenience around the human body is necessary to create useful, integrated, immersive, three-dimensional experiences. A little bit about my past. I love analog. Here are a few things in chronological order of my life, ranging from blocks, Legos, Play-Doh, action figures like Muscle Men, Silly Putty, origami, which is the art of taking two-dimensional content and folding up into 3D content. Pop-up cards, right? Pop-up cards being like those pop-up books where I cut cardstock and glue it together, and all of a sudden you have a two-dimensional thing that can fold out to be three-dimensional. In high school, or junior high, I got really into dancing. And I do this type of dance called liquid, which I'll show you. I just saw this kid doing this in Spanish class one day. And it's sort of born out of the rave culture of the 90s. And I think it's very, very related to computers, and I'm going to talk a lot about this today. Because I think that understanding space from a dancer's point of view, you know, that's a very, very strong understanding of space and a very strong understanding of how to communicate space, how to communicate meaning through space. I perform magic, mostly card magic and coin magic, and do juggling, contact juggling. I really fell in love with theater in high school. And in theater, right, this is, I fell in love so much with it that I actually went to theater school, and this is what is known as black box theater. This is sort of what all theater artists nowadays are working with. Basically, it's just a big room. You have chairs, and it's a three-dimensional space. You play around inside this three-dimensional space to create 3D experiences. Right? And upon graduating theater school, I realized I didn't really like theater. It turns out that I liked learning about theater. I liked learning about creating 3D environments that are interactive. And actually, to sum up all of my two-dimensional or my three-dimensional digital experience and my passion for digital 3D, I can sum it up in two words: Counter-Strike. This is a video game that I played countless hours in high school. And basically, upon graduating theater, I realized that these digital. So, for those of you who aren't acquainted, Counter-Strike is a game where you just run around and you hold a gun and you shoot your friends on a multiplayer map. What I realized was that these two spaces are actually very, very similar, right? Because in the theater space, you have it's a virtual environment with all these set parameters. You have all this interesting design going on. You have lighting design. The four designers on the theatrical team are usually lighting designers, sound designers, set designers, and costume designers. You have actors walking around on stage with predetermined schedules. You have all these things occurring. You have events firing and triggers happening. It's the exact same thing as this thing, right? I mean, you have a set, which is the map you're playing on. You have costumes, and you know who you need to shoot, who you need to be friends with. There are all these lighting triggers, so that you know where there are flashbangs in this game, there are like sounds and footsteps, so that you can cue yourself to know where people are coming from. And timing is very, very important in it too. So the realization that these two spaces were actually very closely related, so big to me, and I knew that now I had the skills to create digital, or now I knew I had the skills from theater to create any three-dimensional space I kind of wanted to. I went around on the internet and did some research and I found this thing called the P5 glove. It's a very trashy piece of hardware. Basically, you put it on, it tracks your hand in 3D space. It also tracks when you're flexing your hand. And to sort of demonstrate how I feel about the 3D, about the P5 glove, I pulled up this video last night. This is from a movie called The Wizard, released in like 1989. It was basically the introduction that most of that world had with this thing called Power Glove and Nintendo's Mario 3.
Power glove. Love the Power Glove. It's so bad.
I love the Power Glove. It's so bad. For those of you who are too young, there was actually a time in history where the word bad meant good sometimes, and I think it was fun. No, but with this Power Glove, when I discovered this P5 glove, I knew that like hardware would be awful, but it was this like promise, right? For me, it was this experience that like people like. Put my hand in cyberspace, right? I'd be able to bridge the gap. I'd be able to stand in a theater and put my hand in a Counter-Strike. Right? And it's this really physical experience where I was like, wow, as a dancer, I just like doing this activity anyway. Right? But if I were to be able to put a machine on me to be able to facilitate that, this is all just like brain dumping. I'm not really sure at this point where I'm headed with this. So I tried to figure out how to conceptualize digital 3D space in real 3D space. How to bridge that gap between that which is in Counter-Strike and that which is on stage. And I came up with this idea called the digital litmus test. And the idea was that if you had an LED that was off all the time, but was tracked in 3D space, and you just pass it around a room, and then as soon as the LED enters the region that the machine is thinking about, the LED turns on, right? And then it turns off and leaves. And the idea here is that so as an actor, you know, I can pretend to be a computer, and as a dancer, I can like manipulate that. I can train 10 other dancers to do this. But if you're just a normal participant who's walking by, you're not going to think twice about it. You're not going to be able to know unless there's a set convention. We have a lot of theater tricks to do that, but I wanted to figure out how to get a technology to do that. So this digital litmus test idea allowed a user with no acquaintance of the space to be able to rub through, and you know, let's say we have a plane right here that's like 6 inches deep. It's a wall, right? The way you'd scrub your litmus test around, you'd be able to get a sense of where this cyberspatial construct is. But I mean, that's sort of, and then you can get more complicated geometry. You can get like a hallway with like door frames or whatever. And physically, it's exhausting, though, right? Because then you're gonna have to like go all around and like try to figure out where things are and where things aren't. But basically, that one thing led to another in my brain, and I just sort of realized that, you know, if you use projectors, and there are different ways to automate this process, and that's where I came up with the exhibition that was going on in the other room, the Marco or the Wire Map. And if you did